Yeah, it's really good. I really like this one. Medicon? I don't know how to pronounce anything. I just typed their thing so that y'all know. Yeah. Cool. Just so you can more clearly see it. The first thing I wanted to talk about this one specifically. Again, it's very, very good. I really like it. But I feel like it's missing a little bit of... some more form in it. Especially in this neck area and in the clothes. You could tell in the original reference photo that it is like naturally just a little bit flat. But it's our job as the artist to try to exaggerate what's being seen and try to give the viewer a sense of feeling in it. So what do I mean by that? The clearest thing I would say with it is the thing right here. So if the face is coming down, if this is facing this way, right? So it's going down this way. If I draw a marker in yours, it kind of just keeps going. But in the reference, do you get the sense of a feeling that it's kind of going down and then it's going back in just a little bit? She is turning and tilting her head just a little bit forward, so the space in between her jaw and the neck itself is going to be closed in just a little bit. So it's important to show that distinct difference, and in yours it's just not there yet. So it kind of goes straight down in a little bit, then back straight down. So the way I would change that is by darkening this area. It's actually a little bit darker in the reference already. So I'll take the value. You could either lighten this area, her face itself, or you could darken this area first. But there is a good reason why I am darkening it first. And that reason is contrast. And I'll show you in a bit why. So, okay. This is the value range that you had here. So if I were just like, here's black, and it goes to white. Right. And it goes to white. So it ends here. Your range that you have, that you had, was here's the value of her face. This is not exact, obviously. This is the value of her face, and this is the value you had for her neck before, right? So if I lighten the value of the face, yeah, it adds a little bit of contrast, a little bit more more dynamic range. So that could work. So you go from this small area to this, right? But look at how much more space we have this way. So if you choose to darken it, you have a lot more options. But you could also just do both and show more separation. But now if you do it too much, you're not going to have any more room to work with anything else. So it's almost like you have a certain amount to spend. I don't know if you can hear my mom, but I think she's calling for my brother. Or my dad. If it was me, she would just walk in. Yeah, so if I decided to move the face lighter, it would be unideal because I wouldn't have much to work with. But if I move the value of the neck lower, I have a lot more room or more bandwidth to do anything. And also, if you are to render out the face, if I were to move the face up, or that cheek, this cheek up, nothing else would be able to, like, if I wanted to lighten things even further, I wouldn't have the space to. So it's all about controlling the values that you're using in order to help yourself be able to have the tools to render out things. That's very important to understand. So I'm just gonna paint this in. And then, yeah, there's that. And then there's gonna be light coming in from the outside, from the area around her. So, you did put it here a little bit, so. But it could come up, under her face. Remember, there's more than what we're just seeing right in front of us. Even if you don't see it directly, you gotta be aware of it being there. Like the underside of her jaw. So I'm just gonna add a little bit more definition to her face. There. And there. I like how you ended blush. It's really good to have hue variation. But unfortunately, I had to knock it out a little bit first. And then put it back in. I wonder if you can hear my mom. And then I like to just take sometimes the darker value that's already there to add a little bit of ambient occlusion. Just to really sell that there's space under her head. Remember, ambient occlusion is only where two things are touching. Almost touching. So that's gonna be there. And then just light on her shoulder. It looks like you already have a good feel for how edges are and stuff. So I'm not gonna get really all too into that. Should be a bit more right there. I think what would help you is to use a lot more bigger strokes and then get more into it, like more smaller and defined brush strokes. That would help a lot, but I think that's more of a style thing, so I'm not gonna really knock you for that. It's a small change, but I feel like it does a lot. There, and then a little bit more definition in her face. Don't be afraid to make things darker. People's faces, it's okay. Like here, could use a little bit more like definition. I'm trying to find my shape first, and then I'm going to find my edge. I feel like here you're just trying to find your edges first. So you, oh, this girl's face is soft, so I'm gonna make sure everything's soft. Now you should think about the edges after the shape. And also don't get too worried if your values aren't exact. Should be just fine. I could use a little bit of definition because there's a little bit of a dip on her mouth. Like on people's mouths, and you didn't show that. I think it's a good thing to show, even just a little bit, just so that the mouth feels connected to the rest of the face. Notice that I'm not really picking like from the color picker, because you already have all your colors that you need here, so there's no need to rely on it too much because everything's there already. Here, just put that back quickly. And then in the nose, you're missing a lot of saturation in the red, because noses always are a little bit more reddish because there's a lot of blood flowing through there, so it's important to make sure that you're getting that. That's very subtle stuff, but because it was already very, very good and I really liked it, so yeah. Yeah, moving on to the next person. Okay, so it turns out that my mic cut out for this part of the stream, so this is a voiceover after the fact of the string. So here I noticed that your nose structure was really good, but I feel like it could be improved by a good margin by adding a bit more complexity and a bit more of a deeper understanding. Because right now you have a good base. So you have like this rectangular form for the nose, and you have a more like this spherical base for the bottom of the nose. But again, you could expand your knowledge on it. And I think that if you just more hone in your understanding and studies and start to get more specific instead of getting these like more broad ideas, it'll really help bring your paintings to life. Yeah, I'm just showing a small example of what to show, like the side plane of the nose and how it's like segmented a little bit. That's just one of the few examples that could help bring your piece to something that feels more grounded and more real. Even if you're not doing something that is real, quote unquote realistic, or you're doing something more similar, it's really good to have a nice understanding of reality. Here I'm explaining how highlights work, or a little bit of it. When you have two planes that meet, you could treat their intersection, not their intersection, their meeting point, or their vertexes, as a place where highlight can be. So if both planes aren't getting direct light and where it's at an angle to create a highlight, the highlight is going to be, or can be, on the transition between them. That's what's happening on the nose layer. Here I am cleaning up your shapes and adding some reflected light to the eye. Your eye's really good. And here I'm pretty sure I'm about to get into like something similar with the nose, where your base, like your old big understanding of the planes in this anatomy, is good. But you could add like these small little notes and small subtle plane changes to it that add just a little bit more depth. And if you have a lot of small, very small details that could just added everywhere, and small like anatomy notes and things that show that you really truly understand what's going on in the face, it helps bring everything together. And here your cheek, you had a shape that was very kind of boring. It was just like a line. So if you start to push that into something more of like a shape that you can design, it's much, much, much better. And here I go into like combining shapes, but I talk about that when my audio comes back. So yeah. It's fine. Okay, so basically what I'm doing here is I connected all the shapes of their beard in order to connect everything. Because before, what you had, you kind of just had small strokes on the face. Like, you kind of just went in, like, one by one. Which you made it look okay. Yeah, but you got it to look okay, but like it's not the best way to go about it. So if you connect everything together, it should be fine. And then you use the edges and the transitions between the shapes to show that texture. It does help a lot with the overall composition. And then maybe you could knock it back if it's too much. So you just take the skin color and kind of just airbrush. is the similar problem with the last person, where it was like there's not a clear enough separation between here and here, so it's a similar thing. It can be done here. But instead I'm gonna lighten that, maybe? Yeah. That's looking better. It was already good before, but I think that's a nice improvement. The hair. Honestly, I struggle with curly hair too. But I would try to focus more on my overall shape. Like, I'll take this, what you have here, and kind of be more clear with it. Be more confident in the shape that you're creating, and the things usually fall right into place. And then I'll just use my blending brush to create more texture. Take this reflective light, actually. Put it more on him. I'll just knock this back a little bit because I think I did a little bit too much. Everything else is pretty okay, but I would add more shadow under the eye because I think you're focusing on making the white of the eye too bright. It's subtle things, but they all add up. Well, I guess the beard thing isn't too subtle. But it's not the biggest thing in the world. So just remember, try to think of more shapes. And in more broader strokes. Yeah. Helps a lot. And I think I kept the integrity of what you did in the beginning there still, so. Yeah. Good work. And then last person is Pam. So yeah, you can already see your tag there. So if you like it, just go ahead and check it out. I really like it. I really like their work. So I really like it. It's really good. It's really, really good, but you're lacking a little bit of detail, especially in the hair. But when you're rendering out two different materials, aka the hair or face and shirt or whatever they're wearing, clothing, it's good to always have a difference in texture or anything, right? You kind of rendered out the hair the same way you did the face, so it's good to vary your techniques and approaches depending on what you're painting. What you chose for the face is really, really good. It's really soft and the edges are really nice. And it's really well done, but you did the same exact thing for the hair. So here you could change up your approach to the hair to something a little bit more textured and more detailed. because you already have a lack of detail on the face. And if you surround that with everything, where everything has a lot of detail, your main focus would be the face. So if I add a little bit more rendering and a lot more angular shapes to the hair, it will help a lot. You have a really good start for it, so it shouldn't be too hard. So my shape language is going to be a lot more different than the face. Here I'm going to use a lot more edges, sharper edges, to show that it's like hair. And I'm going to make sure I go from very large shapes to smaller and smaller. Always thinking of big, medium, small for my shape design. Again, I don't want to stray away from what you already have, because it looks really good. And I could tell you use like glow dodge for the hair, which is really good. Always being able to use what's available to you, knowing how your program works and stuff. It's really good. So always try to work in like from bit really big to really small. Even though I just added a small strand, but let's stay away from that for right now. I feel like these would catch a little bit of top light. And then I really like this red for like subsurface scattering. It looks really good. So I'm changing up my approach. It's more trying to leave in the brush strokes a little bit and using that to imply brush strokes in the hair, or little strands in the hair. It helps a lot. So I like the contrast between here and here, where there's a lot of stuff going on and a lot little going on, but it's almost like this lack of area is competing with the face. So I'm just gonna add a little bit more of detail on this side in order to amend that, because the contrast is in the wrong spot. Contrast is good, but you gotta know when and where to use it. So So you want to make sure you have, you're almost like framing the face with the components around it to create a better composition. And here you kind of missed that, so I'm trying to add that in. Notice I'm not doing anything to the face directly in order to improve it. Not all the problems can be solved by working on the thing that's the problem. So if the hair is the problem, maybe it's actually the face that you could alter a little bit to help suit the hair. Or maybe in gesture, maybe the arm feels out of place because the body is tilted the wrong way. Or the torso is tilted the wrong way. So it's always trying to be able to think outside the box in order to solve your problems that you're having. Oh, okay. So you have the face here, and it's being lit by more of like an ambient light. So what you could do is change up the hue of the ambient light. I'm not doing that, but I think this could be a lot brighter. And then take the subsurface scattering, maybe shift it more red to kind of push that feeling of blood in the nose. Yeah, skip. So if you're having more of like an ambient light that's lighting her face, because her face is in shadow, it's really good to good chance to shift up the hue. Like what I like to do, I like to take the background color, and that's gonna be the hue that the face is going to be leaning towards. So if I add a little bit more of a saturated, like a lighter value, I shift it a little more cyan, and I kind of just inject it into the face. Just to shift the hue just a little bit. Just so you have a little bit more interest. Because you have this very hot white here, and it goes into a red. It's really good to contrast that difference. But again, this is more ambient light, so I'm trying to make sure I don't have any too harsh of edges. This helps with more having more interest. So again, to reiterate, I kind of just took the background and I use that to stem off of like what's gonna be my ambient light color, because ambient light is the light that's around you and affecting whatever it's hitting, not the direct light. I think the eyes are really well done. Looks really good. And then you can add more ambient occlusion, like here. It's a really interesting spot right here, because you could choose to either blend in the hair and the skin a lot, because the values are getting really, really close, and it's good to connect the shapes, just like what I was talking about in the last critique. So you could either choose to leave it like this, where it's almost, they're almost like one, that are getting really close. But you don't want to like have an actual soft edge, because that just looks weird. Or you could choose to separate them with a bit of ambient occlusion, or with some kind of darker value thrown in there. It's really up to you and what you want to do there in those type of situations. But I think here, I'm going to leave it without the, because it's not a focus. Like here would be okay, like in the eye area, to have a little bit more contrast. It makes the thing, makes the eye want to look there. Looks really good. And then now that I have this bluish ambient light, it's gonna be affecting everywhere in the shadow, so I want to make sure that's everywhere. Just to add a little bit more life to the rendering. So I'm kind of just like lightly putting in the blue. This is inspiring me to paint. Well, why not? But why is there quotations? I'm confused. Not with real paints. Digital painting is painting. It's all the same. Just putting colors on a canvas. At least that's my opinion. Sure, yes. I'm glad you agree. Yeah, so I'm trying to add that blue in. So this is ambient light, right? So it's kind of just coming from everywhere. Like, so it's going to be affecting everything. But it's good to think of it in a single direct light almost, and just like taking those hard edges that would usually be there and just softening up. That's how I like to think of it, and it looks a lot better rather than just having it affect like in a full 360, because it helps with form. Like here, I'm thinking of it coming in from the right. And here, I'm thinking of it coming in from the left. Just so that I could have a bit more of a stronger shape language. built up. I think I messed up her face here a little bit. I made her a little more rounded face. But that's not how it was in the original, so. Frick, I erased the thing here. Yeah. Same. Yeah. Ooh, it's getting real dark there, so that's not actually the value. So you want to make sure you incorporate more lights that are relevant to the surroundings. And I have to think about more of like, how is everything affecting your painting? Like, what's your focus? What do you want the viewer to look at? I think you can crop it here just a little bit. Yeah, I think that's alright. I think that looks pretty good. So yeah, I don't really know what else to change. It looks really good to begin with. Just need a little bit more of a push in a compositional sense, in a color theory sense. Yeah. Okay, let's just like